Great singing, church. You may be seated.
Good morning. What a wonderful way to start the worship service. Amen. With that, we decided we needed a few more folks in the choir, so we lowered the entry age, and that's what we got. And so, listen, every once in a while, we'd love to do this. Family worship, right? We want our folks to come. We love it when daughters and moms are standing together in the choir, when dads and sons are worshiping and serving and singing together. What a fantastic picture of the body of Christ. If you guys are out there, your kids are out there, if you guys are interested in being a part of that, they meet every Wednesday night at 6:30. They go up and they don't just sing. It's not just choir. It's not just missions. It's learning about worship. It's learning to live a lifestyle of worship. It's learning to be a missionary wherever you are, okay? Living sin, as Jay tells us every day. They do that every Wednesday night at 6:30. So come on up and be a part of that. We would love to have you. Hey, if you are new, a special word of welcome to you this morning. Thank you so much for being our guest. We would love to know that you're here. We would love to pray for you, maybe get a chance to meet you. There's a communication card at the bottom of your bulletin that you were handed when you walked in. Would you fill that out maybe and just tear it off, drop it in the offering later today, or you can hand it to me. I'll be standing there at the door at the end of the service, and I would love to get a chance to meet you as well. As your gift to us, that would be great. And then, one last thing, it was so good to see all of these kids here, not just for this service, not just for the last service, but can you imagine, they were here for the 8 o'clock service as well. Many of them were. And so they were here and they were praising. If you are thinking about your schedule as you are going along and you're like, you know what, I love coming at 11 o'clock, but for whatever reason, like I'm already up in the morning, just a reminder that we do have other worship options, including one at 8 a.m. every Sunday morning here. As you are considering those options. All right, I tell you what, let's all stand. Let's find somebody you don't know, maybe shake their hand, tell them welcome to the church at Station Hill this morning.
All the second chance.
Exodus 15, 18, the Lord will reign forever and ever.
In this time of desperation,
for the chance to come in here this morning and sing those words and rehearse those things that we believe I know that this has been an extraordinary week. It's been a very politically charged week. There's been a lot of emotions. And it's so good for us to come back and be reminded of what's important and of what actually lasts and who's actually in charge. And so it's just been good for me to sing that three different times this morning. So I hope that you will just take a moment. Right now, this is our prayer and altar time. And so this is our time every week where we just kind of still ourselves. We quiet our hearts. We submit ourselves to God's authority. We put our week that we have ahead, we just put that at His feet and say, God, do what you will with the week ahead. And we just want to trust you with that. And so I hope that in the next few moments when we open the altar, that if you have a burden on your heart and you want to be prayed for, you know that this altar is always open to you. You can always come and know that someone will come and pray for you. But I was thinking this morning, about 10 years ago, there were a group of us that were sitting around every Sunday night in a room, and we were planning and we were praying and we were asking God for direction, and we were just kind of brainstorming, putting up on the whiteboard, like, this is what we want this new church plant, this new campus. We had no idea what it would be called, Station Hill, but this is what we want it to look like. This is who we hope we will be. This is who we hope we'll be known for in our community. And I know Jay still has some of those notes, and it's fun to go back and look and see what those things were that we put on the board. But one of them I remember very clearly. One of them was that we wanted to be a sending church. We did not want to be a place where people just came as spectators, just came, received, and then went back home and went about their business. We wanted to be a church where people came and received, and then they were sent, and they went and took what they knew, and they took it to our community, they took it to the nation, and they took it around the world. And so fall is one of my favorite times around here, because this is when we tend to have most of our journeys are in the fall. And so if you were here last week, you know that we prayed for our South Africa team. We commissioned them before they left. You'll be glad to know they all arrived safely. So I texted Taylor this morning and said, hey, send me a group photo that I can put up during prayer and altar, but don't make it one that's going to make me wish I was there. And that's his sense of humor. He's like, yes, you are going to wish that you were here, but look at that. So they were able to spend yesterday, a little bit of time today doing some sightseeing. The Lord gave them incredible weather to do that. They worshiped together this morning. But this afternoon and this evening, they have been training and they have been preparing, because tomorrow morning, bright and early, they will start doing Holiday Club. So for the next 5 days, they will have hundreds of kids in the morning that they're doing, they call Holiday Club, it's kind of VBS. And then in the afternoons, they'll have teenagers. So you can be praying for them as they prepare to do that and get ready to do that. In the meantime, Friday, dark and early, our Guatemala team will be up and ready, and they will be heading out to go work with our Hope for the World partner, Hope for Tomorrow Children's Home. You can see their names listed there. There's 10 of them. And so in just a moment, I'm going to ask them to come and let us pray for them and let us commission them the same way we did last week. We're so excited about what the Lord will do through them when they are there. And then this is the last Sunday in September, so we will be remembering to pray for the Maratha of India. This is our unreached people group this month. So it's a lot of stuff to pray for. We'll give you a little extra time to do that. But let's remember all of these things as we go before the Lord now. So Guatemala team, go ahead and come on up. Thank you. thank you for this group of people, God, that you have gathered, that you have chosen for such a time as this, Lord. I know that they are filled with excitement. They're filled with anticipation. Some of them have fears, Lord, for the unknown of what you will do, God. But we know that you have ordained this specific moment in time for them to go and work as a team and serve you, Lord. And so I just pray for them. I pray for unity among them, God. I pray for their spirits to be high. I pray that you would keep them free from distraction of things that are happening back home, whether with family or with work, God, that you would just give them peace in those, knowing that details will be covered, will be taken care of, God, and that you will just open their minds, Lord, to whatever it is that you want to show them this coming week. I pray that you would continue to bring them the resources that they need, provide for them, Lord, for those who are still coming up with those resources to pay for the trip. But God, we know that you fund what you favor, and I just pray that you would just blow their socks off with how you do that. God, we pray for our South Africa team as they are attempting to get over jet lag and attempting to get over the very, very long journey there, God, that you would give them the rest that they need tonight. God, even now we pray for those children and those teenagers that will be coming to Holiday Club tomorrow. We pray for their hearts, Lord. We pray for both of these teams that you will give them many, many opportunities to share the love of Jesus, not just physically, not just being his hands and feet, but also that they would have opportunities to have those gospel conversations. And we do pray, Lord, that you would draw people to you this week. I pray that for the Maratha people of India, Lord, I pray that you would continue to spread among that people group where there are churches. We pray that those churches would grow and that they would thrive, that you would give your children there a boldness, Lord, to speak in face of persecution for doing so. And God, we pray for your spirit in this room to move among us, Lord, to be strong, God, to convict us where we need to be convicted, to encourage us where we need to be encouraged, Lord, and to send us to the places that you have already chosen for us to go. We love you, Lord, and we pray all of these things in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Well, good morning, church family. It is good to be back. My wife and I were away last weekend to celebrate our anniversary, 21 years. And so, but we're always glad to be back home and grateful for Brandon Abbott, who did a great job bringing God's word to you last week. This week is week 8 and wraps up our disciple-making series. As we come to the end of this series, I want to remind you of some resources. We want to equip you to carry out the mission of being a disciple-maker. Very first week of the series, we handed you this disciple-making guide. It is a magazine filled with all kinds of practical articles and helps. It's available for you if you didn't pick one up at the Discipleship Center. There are also these spiritual challenge question cards. I want to encourage you to grab some of those. They're always available there as well to be able to put in your wallet, your purse, have with you when you're doing family devotions, stick one in your Bible. Also having the opportunity to share these with your life groups, these 5 spiritual challenge questions will continue to help us help one another stay on track as disciples who are making disciples. Also, you'll remember that we released an app for your phone. So many of these same resources, articles, podcasts, helpful links are available to you there on the app. You can get it for Android or Apple completely free. Also, it helps us if you record those gospel conversations that you're having because we'll be able to discern patterns, areas that we need to strengthen, those kind of things as well. But lots of helpful hints right there at your fingertips via the Brentwood Baptist Church app. And then that app can get you in touch with our gospel conversation coaches. So at each one of our 8 campuses, we are training up a specific group of men and women to help you, to come alongside of you as you share Christ. So if you find yourself discouraged or not knowing where to start, or you're in a difficult conversation facing some hurdles and you need some coaching or help, these 6 people have been equipped and trained by our church multiplication minister, Jason Dukes, and they would love to connect with you. So you can reach out to them via the app. And then these six folks, along with Jason, will be here with us for a lunch and learn on Sunday, November the 11th. And so we'll serve lunch that day and spend a couple of hours kind of kickstarting how to share the gospel, giving you some equipping tools and helping you know how to use these very tools that we have been talking about this morning. So lots of opportunities. We want to be intentional to come alongside of you as you fulfill the Great Commission and as you are faithful to the God who is faithful to you. So as we take up our tithes and offerings today, let's give thanks to the Lord for a church that provides these kind of resources, and let's continue to be faithful with the mission that he's placed in front of us. Join us as we pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you have called us out of the darkness and into the light. And we have the opportunity to help people do the same. And so God, I pray that you'll take these tithes and offerings, God, and as we use them to build equipping tools, to reach out to mission journeys, God, to impact mission partners here at home, that all of these things will be used to make much of Jesus, and that every dollar spent will lift him high so that he will draw people to himself. So thank you that you've entrusted much to us, and now we get to gladly give back to you, and it's in the name of Jesus we pray, amen. Amen. Well, as the ushers are coming by with the offering plates, I want you to go ahead and take your Bibles and turn to 2 Timothy chapter 2. It's where we're going to conclude our series today before we jump into a new series based on the life of Barnabas beginning next Sunday, how we support and undergird what we are doing as a church family. And I want to remind you that with this, we kind of complete our disciple-making strategy that we have rolled out to you. So for the past 8 weeks, we have been preaching the different components of the strategy. First of all, what a disciple is. That's a person who believes and follows Jesus, is being transformed and changed continually by Jesus, and then is living on mission with Jesus. Now, this Sunday, we continue to talk about how that's not a static process, but a fluid one. And it comes out of the overflow of our time in the scriptures and in prayer. It comes as we are intentional to be able to reach out to the lost and searching who are among us. And then the next slide shows you how this all moves and works together, that even as we grow to be more like Christ, we multiply. We are disciples who make disciples. And so I know that's a lot, you know, and we've unpacked it carefully over the last 8 weeks. Excuse me, but we felt like one of the best things that we could do for you as we wrap up this series is to illustrate what this looks like in a life. So in just a moment, I'm going to show you a story, a video story, of one of my friends from the Brentwood campus. Her name is Betty Wiseman. Betty Wiseman, as a young lady, attended Belmont University. She eventually became a professor there, and then in 1968, she started the women's basketball program at Belmont. Now again, get the year, 1968. There were virtually no women's basketball programs in the state of Tennessee. There were very few in the Southeast United States at all. Over the years, Betty did an excellent job and became legendary. Coach of the year 4 times. 4 national invitation tournament invitations for the Belmont women's team. She would run these basketball camps that were legendary. They would draw kids from across the United States. One lady from a little small town in Tennessee in particular by the name of Pat Summit attended Betty's camps. Betty, from that point forward, became Pat Summit's mentor. So this is the lady who mentored the most successful women's basketball coach in college history. And Betty herself was inducted into the Tennessee Sports Hall of Fame just a few years ago. But more important than basketball is the platform that this has provided Betty to be able to disciple young women to follow Jesus Christ. Here is her story. Watch it with us this morning.
I have just been inundated with people in my life who have demonstrated what discipleship really looks like. God has given me a platform through the years, through teaching, through coaching, through working with college students. That's been my calling. That's been a ministry for me. And when I'm with these girls, it's like family. I love them. I want to invest in their lives as long as I possibly can, and sharing the gospel, having gospel conversations.
Ever since I got to Belmont, my faith has has gone from just being, you know, stagnant to something that I grow in every single day now. And I can't thank Betty enough for that, because she showed me the way. I don't think I've seen a woman or anyone so full of love and so full of the Lord like Betty. She lives each and every day for God, and I wanted to be like that. I wanted to live like that, and I just thank the Lord for putting her in my life.
The passion that she brings just on a daily basis is so godly that it's almost impossible not to want to be like that. I'm so thankful and so honored to even know her, but for her to be a part of the women's basketball program, I think there is no better person to, one, start the foundation of a program, but two, be the face of Belmont women's basketball. She's a disciple for Christ every day, and that's big time stuff.
When you get around people like Betty, who is mentoring you, leading you, just leaning into people like us, God's love is spread immensely, and it gives people hope, and it gives people love, and that's something that everybody needs and not everybody feels.
She really pushed me to be somebody that I had no idea I could even be. God is working in everyone's heart, and He is working in my heart. She really allowed me to open up and let Jesus become personal to me and have that personal relationship with Him.
I love Betty and respect her so much. And one of the things that I love about her is she's a role model for many reasons. I mean, we see her in the stands every game cheering us on. We know what she's done for this program, but beyond that, she serves the one who matters. She serves the Lord, and that's what you can tell when you meet her. At the end of the day, all her accomplishments, it's like who she is as a person goes far beyond that. Our relationship goes beyond the court, beyond anything, because she's that role model to everyone that she meets.
Just as God called Moses at 75 to do something big, and I know at 75 years old, I do feel an urgency to complete what God's called me to do. Every day of my life, find opportunities to share Jesus and at the same time make disciples of others so that they carry the message of who Christ is, the difference that He makes in our lives.
I love it. Every day, find opportunities to share about Jesus and make disciples. Betty uses that platform of basketball to do it so well. And I ran into her and some of the girls from the team up at the Brentwood campus a week ago on Monday. They were just returning. She takes the team every year, those who want to go on a mission trip. And three of this year's teammates accepted Christ on that mission trip. And so Betty's as intentional as anyone I know with being a disciple who makes disciples. And it's exactly what Paul was talking to Timothy about in 2 Timothy chapter 2. Will you stand with me in honor of God's word as we read this passage together this morning? You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. What you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, commit to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. Share in suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets entangled in the concerns of civilian life. He seeks to please the commanding officer. Also, if anyone competes as an athlete, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. The hardworking farmer ought to be the first to get a share of the crops. Consider what I say, for the Lord will give you understanding in everything. Speak, Lord, for your servants are listening. Pray with me this morning. Heavenly Father, may your Spirit grant us the ability to consider the life-changing importance of the words that Paul is sharing with Timothy, the importance of the gospel, and the importance that that gospel is handed down from one faithful generation to the next. God, I pray that as we see these examples and word pictures of endurance that Paul gives us, that in a similar way, God, we will be inspired, encouraged, and deepened to know that you entrust to us the opportunity of shepherding others. So Father, would our lives be an offering to you, and would you open our ears and our hearts and our lives to you in this place today? And it's in the name of Jesus we pray these things, and all God's people said, amen. You may be seated this morning. So as we kind of jump into 2 Timothy chapter 2, let's look at some context to kind of gain our bearings, because I think they're vitally important to what Paul is telling Timothy in this moment. Now, most scholars believe that this was kind of Paul's last letter. It was certainly his last letter that we have written to Timothy, who was his son or his protege in the faith. We know that Paul was in prison several times near the end of his life, and in this letter, it indicates, of course, that he is in prison. Scholars are almost sure that they know where, that it was in the infamous Mamertine prison in the heart of Rome. And so I want to put a picture of that prison and the dungeon that's underneath the prison there for you. You had to actually be dropped into this room. It's not tall enough for a man to even stand up in, and this is where Paul spent most of the time awaiting his execution. It's maybe on this little pedestal that he actually wrote this letter, but this place was infamous even among the Romans. A Roman historian wrote this: "It should have been called the House of Darkness. Few prisons were as dim, dank, and dirty as the lower chamber that Paul occupied. Its neglect, darkness, and stench gave it a hideous and terrifying appearance. Prisoners in the ancient world were rarely sent to prison as punishment. Rather, prisons typically served as holding cells for those awaiting trial or execution." So think about that just for a moment. For you and me, when it comes to making disciples, we throw up all kinds of excuses. I'm too busy, I have too much going on, I don't have time to invest in another life in that way. There's all these obstacles. Paul finds himself in a dimly lit dungeon, and yet to the very end, he's still finding a way to make disciples. You heard Betty speak of the urgency that she feels, even at 75 years old. Paul, at the end of his life, an urgency to be sure that light was still coming, even from a dark place like this. And so Paul writes to Timothy in chapter 1 of this book, guard the deposit that's been entrusted to you. You see, Paul understood that the gospel had been entrusted to him, and now he's passing that ministry baton on to Timothy, saying that what has been given to you is of the utmost importance. Now guard it, faithfully pass it on. And at the very end of chapter 1, he calls out a couple of followers who had deserted Paul. He holds up one as an example, but he turns to Timothy and he says, "You therefore," there it is, "my son." And what's the first thing that he tells him? The first thing he tells him is this: be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus, which is our first point this morning. For a disciple who is both maturing and multiplying as a disciple, they live in the strength of the gospel continually. You see, the great temptation of our age and every other age is to think that there's something other than the gospel that we can rely on. There's a temptation to try to turn to our programs, our buildings, our strategies, our efforts, all good things if they're serving the gospel, but not ultimate things. You see, a follower of Jesus knows, and Paul knew this, and he wanted Timothy to be rooted in this, that we can't do much at all in our own strength. Therefore, we need to be strong in the grace that is in the gospel of Jesus Christ. We need to preach the gospel to ourselves every day. It needs to be the place that we start from, the place that we go back to over and over. As a matter of fact, the tense of the original language here, it might be better translated, be continually strengthened in the gospel. Be constantly strengthened in the gospel. Because this is the way of life for those of us who are disciples seeking to make disciples. We don't do it in our own strength. We can't do it in our own strength. So we rely on the resources that God has given us. We don't earn it. We don't deserve it. That's why it's called grace. But because God has rescued us, we know that his grace lives in and through us, and it can flow to others who surround us. And so Paul wanted to remind Timothy, always, when you're thinking about being a leader, when you're thinking about making disciples, go back and start here. Live continually in the gospel of grace. My first assignment in ministry came when I was 19 years old. Youth pastor for a little country Baptist church. We had about 5 teenagers when I started, and every one of them were punks, right? And man, I had my hands full. And as many of you know, you've heard the story before, I wanted to quit a few months in when things got ugly with those teenagers. I wanted to give up. And between some time in my journal and then sitting down with my pastor at the time, Brother Tom Rankin, a bivocational pastor, I heard the words I needed to hear. I told him, Pastor Tom, I think maybe God got the wrong guy. Maybe I'm not cut out for this job. And I'll never forget that he looked across the table in that little church office and said, well, good thing it's not about you. And he was right. It's what I needed to hear. I needed a Paul in my life at that time to remind me the gospel ministry isn't about me. It's about the gospel. And that the resources to carry on in the ministry don't come from me. They come from the gospel itself. And then Tom said, okay, so let's talk about it. What do we need to do? And that's what godly mentors do so well. They remind us first and always of the gospel. And second of all, they see God's grace at work in our lives. They can see things in us that we can't see in ourselves. How God is moving, how God is working, and that blesses us. And that's why this relationship was so important between Paul and Timothy. You see where Paul called Timothy his son. He wasn't his biological son. He was his spiritual son. But he loved him dearly. And by the way, Timothy was no Paul. Timothy was very, very different. If you read between the lines of the New Testament letters, you kind of get a composite picture of Timothy, that he was relatively young, that he was kind of shy and timid. He wasn't near as bold as Paul, and that he had some ailments. He had some stomach issues. We don't know if that's from anxiety or nerves or what. But yet, despite the differences, Paul saw what God could do in Timothy's life, and he encouraged him to live in the strength of the gospel, which leads us to verse 2, which tells us, and that's our second point this morning as well, that a maturing and multiplying disciple of Jesus disciples others in the gospel intentionally. You're not going to just backpedal or wander your way into discipling someone else. We're too self-centered to really look for those opportunities. And we're too distracted, as we'll see in a moment, to prioritize this the way that we should. You have to make a conscious decision to say, you know what? I'm going to invest in others. I want you to take a quick mental check of what you spend your time and your energy on in this past week. Where did you spend most of your time and energy? What did you do with that? Now let me ask this question. What did you do this week that was an investment in something that will outlive you? Convicting, isn't it? That we spend a lot of our time and energy on things that won't matter 50, 100, 200, 1,000 years from now if the Lord tarries. One of the things that Paul knew about the gospel was that it was a priority, that it had to be handed off. Investment had to be made in the next generation of leaders so that the gospel witness would continue. There is a chain of truth, so to speak, that Paul wanted to be sure that was not broken. Look with me at verse 2. What you have heard from me in the presence of many witnesses, now you commit to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. So let's walk this out, right? Paul encountered Jesus on the Damascus Road, and Jesus saved him and called him. Now, Paul has invested and poured into Timothy, raised him up as the pastor of the church at Ephesus, a church that had regional influence for all of Asia at that time. Then Timothy was supposed to identify faithful men who were going to do what? Be able to teach others also. And think about this. Remember the picture that I just put on the screen a few moments ago. Today, we stand here reading this passage because for over 2,000 years, the chain has been unbroken. From Paul, that letter got to Timothy from that dungeon. From Timothy, it was given to faithful men. Those faithful men were trained up to teach, and on and went until the gospel came to you and me today. From that Roman prison, if we could see what God sees, we could draw a line to a hillside in Spring Hill, Tennessee today, in which we are studying this passage. Why? Because men were intentional to disciple other men. Women were intentional to disciple other women. And the gospel has come to you and to me. And that's the kind of life that we want to leave and the kind of legacy that we want to have. We want to invest in the things that matter. So how do we find faithful leaders? Our International Mission Board says, look for leaders who are fat, F-A-T, all right? And by that, I'm not talking about physical attributes. I'm talking about spiritual ones. Faithful. The word that's used here, right? Faithful to the gospel and to the word of God, available, willing to be used whenever and however God chooses. And number three, teachable, teachable. You see, those who are mature in the gospel know they don't have it all together, right? They know they don't have it all figured out, but they have figured out that they are continuously in need of the gospel and that their priorities have to be shaped by the gospel. And so one faithful disciple raises up another disciple, and so the chain goes on. Are you going to let the chain end with you? Are you going to let the chain end with you? The gospel came to you. Who are you passing it on to? That's the priority that Paul wanted to understand in the life of Timothy, because he knew that the gospel was so precious that it must be handed off, passed down from generation to generation to generation. And if there's something that we're lacking today in our churches, especially in the United States and in North America, it's probably 2 Timothy 2:2 type of ministry. We're actually learning from our friends on the mission field and our brothers and sisters in the two-thirds world what this looks like. Because in the North American church, we've become over-reliant on big buildings and expensive programs instead of just basic one-on-one disciple making. I have a pastor that I've been reading recently, and he compares this kind of ministry to the game of golf. Any golf fans out there? Anybody going to put on the golf game and take a nap this afternoon as you guys watch the match, the Ryder Cup or whatever's going on this weekend? So I didn't know much about golf growing up. I didn't play it. I played baseball. Hence why my golf swing is so bad to this day. But the first pastor I served under full-time in Alabama, that was his thing. So it was just me and him on staff. So we had our staff meetings on the golf course. He gave me an old set of clubs. We'd go out on the local public links there in North Alabama, and we'd play nine holes or so. And so I learned a few things from him about golf. One was, you got different types of clubs in your bag, right? And in the same way, there's different types of ministry in the church. And so one author compares your driver, or your woods, as they're sometimes called, right, to the preaching ministry of the church. When you get up on the tee box to hit your ball, you know, when you swing that big club, it's impressive. It can be showy if you know how to hit it right. It can make this great ping noise as that ball flies down the fairway if you're a good golfer. That's kind of like the preaching ministry of the church. It covers a lot of ground. It's the most broad, right? It can be kind of showy at times. That's the preaching ministry. Then, as you approach there off the fairway, you use your irons. And as I have a friend who says, it's not just how you drive, it's how you arrive. And so how you use your irons requires a little more precision and finesse. You've got to pick the right iron for your distance out the hole. You've got to be able to use that iron properly to get the right loft on the ball so it lands on the green. That's like the teaching ministry of the church. There's a lot of preaching that takes place. There's a lot of teaching that happens in our context and life groups and focus studies. It's a little bit more precise. It's a little bit more targeted. But then, and this is what I'm told separates the men from the boys, there is putting. And if you're an amateur like me, you're like, oh, putting, that's got to be the easy part, right? Like, what's the big deal with putting? Like, you're close to the green, you just got to tap it in, that's all it takes. And then you like seven putt a hole like I do, and you realize just how challenging it is to putt. Your professional golfers will say this: you drive for show, but you putt for dough, right? It's how they make their living. Because it's actually extremely difficult to read a green in the right way, to putt precisely with the angle that you need to get that ball in the hole very quickly. And so in the church, that would be comparable to discipling one-on-one or mentoring. It's personal, it's up close, but it takes a special skill set. And we love the show, and sometimes we love the irons. But that personal one-on-one ministry, investing in the hard work that it takes, that's what we're lacking so often. And that's what the church needs. It doesn't have to be showy, it doesn't have to be flashy. But discipleship that makes disciples has to be personal. It has to be one-on-one. And it's amazing to see how God uses that. Now, it's challenging. And that's the very next thing that Paul is going to tell Timothy. He gives us three very helpful word pictures. I love that in Paul's teaching, because just like any of us, like you guys are kind of starting to fade right now, about two-thirds of the way through the sermon, right? It helps us come up for air. Paul does the same thing. Three pictures. The first one, a dedicated soldier. So our third point tells us that we have to endure for the gospel faithfully. And that word picture that he starts with is that of the soldier. If you look with me in verse 3, he says, share, a word that can also be translated enlist, right? Or join the ranks of suffering as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. Yes, he uses the word suffering. It's going to take the investment of your time and energy. You're going to have to get involved in somebody else's messy discipleship life. It's suffering. It's intentional. So share in it as a good soldier of Christ Jesus. No one serving as a soldier gets entangled in the concerns of civilian life. He seeks to please the commanding officer. And it's that word entangled that stuck with me this week. Because I think in our suburban context, if there's anything that we struggle with, it's that we get entangled in a lot of good things that are not great things for the kingdom of God. So we say yes to a lot of the things that are just part of our culture without realizing that then those things take our time and our energy and our resources away from the great thing of the one mission that we're supposed to have, being disciples who make disciples. A soldier enlists, and in doing so, right, gives up a lot of his other commitments, if not almost all of them, because he's going to be assigned somewhere in the world where he's needed. He's not going to pick when he gets to wake up or what his duties for that day are going to be or what he gets to eat for lunch. He surrenders those things as a dedicated soldier. Why? So they can accomplish the one mission that the commanding officer is driving towards, that he is seeking to accomplish. That's the first word picture that Paul gives us. The second one is this, the disciplined athlete. The disciplined athlete. Here's what he says about the athlete. He says also, if anyone competes as an athlete, he is not crowned unless he competes according to the rules. So on one level, we get this, right? For an athlete to be successful, they have to show extraordinary discipline. They have to get up early before everybody is up early to run, to work out, to exercise. They watch what they eat. There's extraordinary discipline that takes place here. But Paul says if they're going to get the crown, and that's a reference to the laurel wreath that the competitors in the Greek games would achieve, then he says they are going to have to compete according to the rules. And so it's interesting, right? There's no shortcuts, is what Paul is telling us. No performance-enhancing drugs, no scuffing the baseball, right? Instead, you've got to be intentional and to compete. But one thing that I discovered in my study this week was that athletes in the Greek games had to commit to an oath. They had to recite an oath saying that they had committed 10 months of preparation in advance of the games to know that everyone would be competing at a high level. In the same way, right? How many of us are willing to put in that kind of work to even be able to compete, to get in the game? Little side note, me and the preaching team, if we're talking about this passage and we talked about the fact that we think in modern day Olympics, it would be a lot more entertaining, speaking of discipline, to put like an average Joe like me out there with all of those sprinters or runners for comparison. See, those guys are all world-class athletes, but if you want to see how good they really are, put one of us out there against them, and then you'll get a picture, a more realistic picture of how disciplined these guys really are. It's what Paul's talking about. There are no shortcuts. You've got to do the work. You put it in day by day, moment by moment. But this third word picture I love as well. It's the picture of the diligent farmer. My mom's side of the family is a long line of farmers, and so this word picture resonates with me because I remember my grandfather who got up right before the sun, who often came in for dinner after the sun had already set, who there's always work to be done on the farm, always something that needed repairing, always ground that needed tilling, seeds that needed sowing, weeds that needed pulling. There's always something that the farmer's doing. But what makes this one a little unique from the other two examples is what? Well, we'll sometimes honor our soldiers for our service, their service to our country. We'll sometimes praise athletes, or athletes will have their moment, right, when they finally win the race or they win the big game. But have you ever heard of a farmer who called like a press conference to announce he was gonna bale hay this fall? Have you ever heard and across the headlines, you know, farmer signs 5-year $1 million contract? No, but yet you go to the grocery store and you reap the benefits of the farmer's hard work all the time. Have you ever stopped there in the grocery store to think about what it took for that product to get into your hands so that you and your family could eat? It's unheralded. It's unrewarded for the most part. But there is a promise that Paul makes. There will be fruit, right? And the farmer gets the satisfaction of knowing, even if nobody else sees, even if there's no other applause, that his efforts have produced fruit. And the same is true for a true disciple maker. They know that most of their work happens when no one else is watching. And yet they are willing to invest. They're willing to pour into the lives of others. And the ultimate example Paul gives us, and this is our fourth and final point today, is this, is that maturing and multiplying disciples of Jesus, remember that it was Jesus who endured it all for us. Picking up where we left off with verse 8, remember Jesus Christ, risen from the dead, Paul writes, descended from David, according to my gospel for which I suffer to the point of being bound like a criminal. I love this phrase, but the word of God is not bound. As Paul is bound in a dungeon, he knows that spiritually the word of God is not bound. It won't return void. And so he says, this is why I endure all things for the elect, so that they may also obtain salvation, which is in Christ Jesus with eternal glory. This saying is trustworthy. So brothers and sisters, disciple makers, hear this. For if we died with him, we will also live with him. If we endure, we will also reign with him. If we deny him, he will deny us. If we are faithless, he remains faithful, for he cannot deny himself. It's who he is. He is faithful to us. And so as we come to the conclusion of this series, I want to remind you of a quote that I started this series with from our outgoing IMB president, David Platt, who's talking about the Great Commission that we are all called to make disciples. And he says this, in Matthew 28, the command is clear, make disciples. But the command has been compromised. We have become entangled in civilian affairs, as Paul would say. We are tempted in the local church to do everything except the one thing Jesus told us to do. Jesus never told us to construct church buildings, organize programs, build schools, colleges, universities, or seminaries. None of these things are bad, but these things are only good if they help us make disciples. But Jesus did clearly tell us to make disciples in every part of the world. So are we answering his command? Are we being faithful to him? Takeaway number one for us today. And by the way, I just have two. Brandon only gave you one last week, so I didn't want to give you whiplash like going back to three, okay, in 1 week. So takeaway number one for you is this. The most meaningful offering that we can bring Jesus is another disciple. Have you ever thought about that before? Sometimes our heart full of grace, gratitude. Oh, Jesus, you have saved me. You've rescued me. You love me. You've given me what I don't deserve. You've given me a security and inheritance. What could I possibly do for you? Obey him. Obey his command. Make disciples who make disciples until he returns. That's what you can do for Jesus. That's what honors him the most. How do we do it? Takeaway number two, asking yourself these two honest, simple questions. Who are you discipling? As we've talked about this morning, has it been convicting to you? Is there a name? Is there a face? Maybe it's in your own home. It may be your own children. It may be your own spouse. Is there a friend, a coworker, an extended family member, someone who you know God has placed in your path so that you can teach them what God has taught you? It's the essence of disciple making. The gospel that has come to you now flows through you into the lives and hearts of other people. And then this question, who is discipling you? Are you humble? Have you gone to someone and said, you know, I can see God at work in your life. As you follow Jesus, would you help lead me? I have questions. I have some things that don't make sense. I want to know him more, and I see the way that you know him, and that moves me deeply. Who are you discipling? Who is discipling you? Would you bow your heads with me this morning as we come to this time of response? I know those questions seem simple, but just as Paul knew with Timothy, the answer to those questions matters because the future of the gospel hinges upon our faithfulness to communicate it and live it from generation to generation. So are you investing in the things that will matter 50, 100, 150, 1,000 years from now? Or are you entangled in other commitments? My prayer all week is that the gospel of grace would set you free. In just a few moments, we're gonna hear a beautiful song sung over us. It's called the Christian's Daily Prayer. You could also title it the Disciple Maker's Daily Prayer, as this song weaves together many of the elements that we've talked about today. We're gonna stand and join in the last verse, but let's hear the first couple of verses sung over us. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you that you help us to make disciples in obedience to your command, and it's in your name we pray, amen.
Strength fades like the light.
Thank you, Jenna. And what powerful words for us to end this series on. The desire of our heart would be that God would be glorified in and through us as we're disciples who make disciples. So today, if you need to respond to his word in any way, if you need to turn from your sin and yourself and your striving and to the Savior whose grace is sufficient for you, then that's why we're here today. I'll be down front in just a few moments. Our decision counselors are coming. They'll be to my right and my left. So there are people for you to pray with and talk with as you process and respond to the work of the Spirit by his word in your heart and in your life today. Maybe you're convicted that you need to disciple someone and you want us to pray with you for that relationship and opportunity. Maybe today you realize, hey, I need discipled, and you want to reach out. However you need to respond, that's why we're here. Brian and Brandon, they'll be in the back. If you need to take some next steps in regards to knowing more about our church, getting connected here, they're here for you as well. But church family, we go to glorify Jesus by being disciples who make disciples. So you are loved and you are sent. Have a great Sunday.